So we're picking right back up where we left off in terms of talking about different kinds of drugs, different kinds of medications. We talked about the group one, which were the anxiolytics, anti-anxiety medications like benzodiazepines. We talked about barbiturates. And so we've also talked about schizophrenia as a condition. And here we're getting to the antipsychotic agents. And so looking at the history, of course, before we had medications to treat people with, for example, schizophrenia, the rate of institutionalization was pretty high. So people having to live in an institution, a mental institution, because there was no treatment. You know, those numbers have decreased since the invention of medications for that. So the first set of medications are called sort of the first generation, or referred to as typical antipsychotics. Chlorpromazine, haloperidol are examples of the first generation antipsychotics. And what makes these different from the second generation, which we're going to talk about in a little bit, is that these are really, really good at blocking the dopamine receptors D2. So these specific D2 receptors, they also do a much better job of reducing the positive symptoms of schizophrenia. However, they don't really touch the negative symptoms of schizophrenia. So just as a reminder, we talk about positive symptoms. This is like the addition of something that really shouldn't be there. For example, hallucinations, paranoia, things like that, delusions. And negative symptoms are ones where things are not present when they should be. So, for example, we could see lack of emotion, we can see a lack of motivation, lack of speech, things like that. And so these particular first generation medications are all, you know, helpful to treat some things, but they of course do have side effects. One particular set of side effects is that the symptoms look really similar to Parkinson's disease. And if you remember, the Parkinson's disease is caused by dopamine depletion in the basal ganglia. And so, you know, if you are experiencing large doses or maybe incorrect doses of the first generation medication and it's blocking D2 dopamine receptors, then of course that makes sense that the side effects of this would look similar to a condition where dopamine is being depleted, because dopamine basically reduces to the point where it's not typical. And so what we typically see in these kinds of side effects is reduced motor activity, again, looking very similar to Parkinson's disease. Now, once the medication is stopped, we may see some improvement. However, there are some conditions as a result of the first generation typical antipsychotic medications that are irreversible. And some long-term effects, for example, dyskinesia, this is the distortion in involuntary movement, where we see people basically moving almost like ticks, where they don't want to, you know, they're not meaning to move that way. That can actually be a side effect, a result of the medication itself. Tardive dyskinesia is also one example of this, where we see repetitive movements. It's a type of dyskinesia where we see, for example, a person might move their face, they might move their mouth, lips, or tongue in a repetitive fashion. So this particular person, as you can see, has got their tongue stuck out, and they also are closing their eyes, and that might be a repetitive movement that they can't control. You might also see somebody licking the sides of their mouth. They might be, you know, moving their face in a contorted way, repetitively, and they don't have control over those movements. So just kind of being aware that although we might see that these first generation medications are treating the condition, they also come with risks and side effects. Now, typical antipsychotics, first generation medications, they are, like I said, these D2 receptor antagonists. And so typically what we see is, depending on the medication, so here's a really nice kind of table. So looking at the affinity from low to high affinity to dose, right? So the clinically effective dose of a typical antipsychotic can be predicted from its affinity for D2 receptors. So for an example, haloperidol has a great affinity. As you can see, it's ranking on the higher end of the affinity, okay? And you know, in terms of like a lower dose compared to like over here, for example, has a high affinity, and doesn't necessarily need As you can see here, haloperidol is on the higher affinity with, but doesn't necessarily need as high of a dose. So, you know, it's in a more sort of safety zone compared to clozapine, for example, having to have a much higher dose, and it has a lower affinity for those D2 receptors. And so haloperidol is one particular medication that is used pretty widely today. Now, so that's the first generation antipsychotics. Here, if we look at the second generation, we call atypical antipsychotics. Clozapine is a good example of that. We saw that here, having not as high of an affinity for those D2 receptor compared to the other particular medications. So here we see they weakly block these D2 receptors, but okay. It also blocks serotonin receptors. So it's specific to 5-HT2 receptors, okay? Now, so you might say, well, if the, you know, first generations, we want to see them have a really high affinity to these D2 receptors. Clozapine is an example where it doesn't have as high of an affinity. However, okay, these particular typical antipsychotics don't do that we know of a separate function of blocking these 5-HT2 receptors. So what these second generation atypical antipsychotics do is it's able to sort of act dually, right? So weakly block those D2 receptors, but also block the serotonin 5-HT2 receptors. And in that, we've found that they also not only do they treat some of the positive symptoms, but unlike the first generation typical antipsychotics, they can actually reduce the negative symptoms as well. So some examples that I gave you is, for example, lack of speech, lack of motivation, social withdrawal is also an example, that blunted emotional response. And so we see some of these negative symptoms in schizophrenia being able to be treated because likely it's able to also block these 5-HT2 receptors. So we can see it affect motivation. We can also see it reduce agitation, so it's helpful. But one common complaint on the second generation ones is that they result in weight gain, which you can say, you know, even just kind of looking at the drug in of itself being able to affect motivation, a person, it might just sort of bring back a healthier appetite versus if they lacked motivation before, they might have lacked motivation to eat. So you know, although the drug itself could be causing this weight gain in of itself, but by helping the effects of the condition, the symptoms of the condition, you're going to see a person gain weight anyway. But this particular medication has been shown to result in weight gain. Now, so these atypical second generation antipsychotics, they do successfully treat schizophrenia by blocking the serotonin receptors and, although weakly, those D2 receptors. You can see that in some cases they actually do increase dopamine levels in the frontal cortex. So again, having multiple actions as well. And if you look at this kind of just total full graph of typical here versus atypical antipsychotics, you can see down here it's color-coded based off of which receptor it's impacting, and so or in terms of affinity, like which one is it which ones are they binding and they have the highest affinity for. And you can see here that this is high affinity versus low affinity, and then all of the drugs in between. And so you can see that, for example, drugs that block dopamine receptors, specifically like the D2 variety, which is in purple, they're more effective in combating symptoms of schizophrenia. And if you look at atypical antipsychotics like clozapine, for example, blocking those 5-HT2 receptors, and you can see that in green, those more effectively, they block those more effectively than they do the D2 receptors. So if you look, for example, here, you can compare the green 5-HT to serotonin receptors to, for example, the dopamine DT receptors. So you see here they have a higher affinity for the serotonin versus the dopamine. And you can make sort of comparisons across the different atypical versus typical antipsychotics and see the trends there. Now, when it comes to trying to understand what this is, and we've talked before about the fact that a lot of the medications that are being used to treat these conditions were found by accident, right? So it just so happens that there was, maybe a trial going on that treated a particular symptom of something, and then it turns out, oh, wow, look, it does this other thing and helps this other condition. And so because we don't really 100% know what causes schizophrenia and why a person develops particular symptoms, we have to think of different theories and guesses and hypotheses as to what could be causing the condition. So one particular and one of the strongest explanations for why schizophrenia occurs is the dopamine hypothesis. So the dopamine hypothesis comes from the idea that schizophrenia is a result of too much dopamine activation. So there's excessive synaptic dopamine or too much activation from dopamine receptors. Okay, and the reason why we have this hypothesis, there's two major reasons why. So number one, when you give a person who has schizophrenia an antipsychotic drug that works primarily by blocking D2 receptors, and we see a reduction in symptoms, specifically positive symptoms, right? Then that must mean that there's a connection, right? So if the drug reduces or blocks these D2 receptors and makes the person better, then the resulting thought is schizophrenia must be caused in some way by too much dopamine. Okay, if we can block the dopamine and improve their condition. So that's our first kind of like number one guess and evidence, I should say, for our hypothesis. The second piece of evidence that we have is because people can experience something called amphetamine psychosis. So essentially, when a person is taking a large amount of amphetamines, okay, this is a person without schizophrenia, okay, takes a large amount of amphetamines, it causes a state that looks so much like schizophrenia that unless you're a trained clinician and know to ask certain questions, you may not be able to tell them apart. So you would not be able to tell a person going through a non-person, a person without schizophrenia going through amphetamine psychosis versus a person who has schizophrenia going through a break, a psychotic episode. Okay. Because of this, because that it's very difficult to tell these apart. And really the question is you have to ask the person, have they used any substances, right? So because this second piece of evidence, this amphetamine psychosis occurs, okay, this gives us more evidence that must have something to do with dopamine. And the reason why is if you look at how amphetamines work. So here we see this sort of picture here talking about agonists. So here we have this amphetamine and cocaine. They block the reuptake of dopamine, meaning that there's more dopamine available, right? If we look at amphetamine also acting, so not only acting here in the reuptake, but also acting on the release of dopamine. So not only is it promoting more dopamine being released, okay, it's also making sure that more stays in the cleft and is not getting taken back up with the transporters. And so because of these amphetamine agonists, okay, or excuse me, dopamine agonists, which are amphetamines, okay? And these amphetamines are promoting just a very large amount of release of dopamine and then prolonging that in the cleft by blocking reuptake. Okay, this is mimicking what we see with schizophrenia. So again, these are two pieces of evidence, this amphetamine psychosis and then antipsychotic drugs. The mechanism of antipsychotic drugs here, they work as an antagonist. So clozapine works by occupying the D2 receptor site. So it does not allow those receptors to activate. So it decreases the amount of dopamine in the system. And when we see this happen, right, this is treating the schizophrenia as a condition, right? This is treating those positive symptoms. So with the combination of antipsychotic drugs work for a lot of people. They work by blocking dopamine 2 receptors, decreasing dopamine in the brain in a person with schizophrenia. And we have amphetamine psychosis. Second part of this evidence, right, is that people who are not who do not have schizophrenia, it mimic almost what looks like schizophrenia by a large increase in dopamine. So therefore, it must mean that dopamine is the answer, right? Too much dopamine. Now, the problem with this is that, of course, it's a hypothesis. There's some support for it, but it's not definitive. There are several problems with the dopamine hypothesis. So, for example, one issue is that those drugs that block the D2 receptors, okay, they block those receptors faster than the person experiences a reduction in symptoms. You would think that if it's just sheerly the increase in dopamine, that once you resolve that and reduce that dopamine, that the symptoms should stop immediately, but they don't. Okay? It takes time. It takes time for that person needs to take the medication for weeks in order to see improvement. Some people simply do not respond to the dopamine antagonists, right? So some people are not responding to these antipsychotic drugs. And so you would say, okay, if they're not responding, that doesn't make sense because if everybody had a problem with too much dopamine with schizophrenia, then we should see everybody respond to the drug, but that's not the case. We also see a lot of other neurochemical abnormalities, which we're going to talk about here in just a minute, that are also affected in people with schizophrenia. So it's not just dopamine, right? And here are some other examples of differences that we see across the board when it comes to people with schizophrenia. So, for example, we see glutamate being affected, right? We see GABA being affected. We see a lot of not just the D2 receptors, but we see other dopamine receptors, D3, D4, for example, having some different differences in a person with schizophrenia versus not. So it's not just dopamine, it's not just the D2 receptors. There's a lot more going on. So that is the dopamine hypothesis. Looking at other hypotheses, okay, so specifically the glutamate hypothesis. So one interesting kind of take on, okay, maybe it isn't dopamine, or maybe it's not only dopamine, okay, is looking at how people take other kinds of drugs. So in a person who does not have schizophrenia, who's taken PCP or phencyclidine, right, also called angel dust. So PCP is a psychotomimetic, meaning that it's kind of it's miming what looks like schizophrenia. PCP can actually produce positive and negative symptoms of schizophrenia. And so the way that it works is that PCP works on an NMDA receptor, okay? Now, NMDA receptors are really important for learning and memory, okay? So learning especially is where we see NMDA receptors being really active. So this whole process of ATP, which we didn't really get too much into this class, but you will learn in if you take a learning course. Okay. Now, PCP acts as an antagonist to the NMDA receptor. It prevents glutamate from binding to the NMDA receptor. Essentially, it works by using magnesium to block the activation. Okay, because these NMDA receptors need different things like zinc, for example, to work. And if you want the process of learning to occur, you've got to essentially unblock this NMDA receptor. You've got to take that magnesium out. Well, what PCP does is it essentially blocks this process and doesn't allow these NMDA receptors to work. Okay, so again, remember PCP is causing both positive and negative symptoms. Now, there are other NMDA receptor antagonists, like ketamine, for example, that work very similarly and again produce really similar effects. So, when you are looking at somebody who is exhibiting symptoms, who who is not does not have a diagnosis of schizophrenia, okay, by taking drugs like PCP, ketamine, whatever, and those drugs are specifically blocking glutamate from functioning, then you say, okay, well, perhaps people with schizophrenia have underactivation of glutamate receptors if PCP and ketamine, specifically with PCP, works as an antagonist to glutamate, then perhaps schizophrenia is caused by not enough glutamate working, or not enough glutamate receptors working. So again, another theory, another hypothesis to what could potentially be happening. So the next series of slides, we're going to talk about group three, antidepressants and mood stabilizers. So hop on over to that one for the next part.